This is Neil Jones. We are here at Bloodstock, a man who knows all about Bloodstock. He played the very first one. It's Biff Byford from Saxon. How are you?
Did we play the first one?
Was it the first? One of the first ones.
I believe, yeah. Yes. 2001. I'm only pulling your leg, yeah. I remember. It was good fun. Yeah.
It was indoors those days, wasn't it, of course?
Derby Assembly Rooms. Yeah, actually, it's an old gig from the 80s. We used to play there in the 80s back in, you know, the Wheels of Steel Strong and the Law days. So it's like Sheffield City Hall, Derby Assembly Rooms, you know. So, yeah, it was on the map, definitely.
And your association with the Gregory family in terms of artwork, was that already established at that point?
Yeah. Paul did the Crusader, was his first album, which was 1984, I think. I think it was 84 or 85. So, yeah, we've known Paul for a long, long time.
Well, listen, let's get the C word out of the way, the other C word, COVID. It obviously...
Have you got it?
No, I sincerely hope not. It's debilitated, you know, all musicians' careers in one way or another for that 18-month period. Rewinding, were you guys in touring mode? Were you in writing mode at the time?
Well, we've actually released... my solo album came out just as COVID happened, actually. So that was a bit kiboshed. And then we did the Inspirations album, which is a cover album. I've just done an album with my son that came out 2 weeks ago. So we've been really busy, actually, myself anyway. I don't think the rest of the band been too much apart from the Inspiration. Yeah, I mean, it's an opportunity to do some things on the bucket list, really. And the Heavy Water thing is going really well. It's getting a lot of airplay in America, so really good, you know.
Well, listen, we've got Sebastian on the same show that this interview is going out with as well, talking about that band on your t-shirt there. You play the bass on this as well, don't you? A lot of people didn't realize you were a bassist.
Well, I was a bass player when I first started, you know, back in the day before I met Paul Quinn, when I was like, you know, 19 or something, I don't know. It's because I learned to play guitar and then I moved to bass. So yeah, I played bass all my life, basically. Yeah. And I had a Rickenbacker back in the day, you know, 70s Rickenbacker. So, I play a lot. When we're writing songs, I'll play a lot of bass, and Nibs will sometimes play keyboards or guitar. So we all switch around a bit. We're pretty multi-instrumental, really. So, I like playing bass. I played bass on the album, and we're going to do another album, apparently, and... we might do a tour on that album, you know, so I'll play bass on that.
We'll actually get to see you playing bass on stage then.
Oh, yeah. Play bass and singing. It'll last that long. Hey, yeah.
And am I right in saying the album came about because Sebastian was living in Manchester but moved back home and it basically brought you together in the same space, so you just started jamming together, is that right?
Well, a lot of the songs are Sebastian's songs that he wrote while he was in Manchester, stuck in his flat. You know, I did a few lyrics things with him and some melodies, but most of the actual songs, the riffs and things, are all his, really. Yeah. So I can't really claim any sort of, you know, like, you know, the title track is basically his. I mean, we arranged a few things, but it's really refreshing to sing a different style of rock music. And, you know, his influences are a lot more modern than mine. So I think it sounds great mashed together. You know.
And when we were talking last about the Inspirations album, you were saying that there will probably be another one of those because you just had a blast doing it.
Yeah, I've got the songs in my pocket that we're going to be doing, which I'm not telling you. But now we're just finalising it now, what songs to do.
Okay.
I mean, we've already done quite a lot.
Yeah.
So it's difficult. I mean, I want to do a Who song. You know, I want to do... Well, I'm not telling you.
Just tell me the other 10 and then we're there.
Do a Who song on the last one. I couldn't find one. Because the thing is, we have to bring something to the song, yeah. And, you know, we did a UFO song for the album. But actually, it didn't sound too much different to UFO. We couldn't really bring anything to it.
You couldn't Saxonize it.
Song, yeah. Shoot, because, you know, it's their song, right? What can I say? It's a great version, but it's just didn't have that extra little bit of, you know, something that you need to be on an album as an inspiration, you know.
But you're also saying that with certain songs, I mean, AC/DC, I think, was a good example. Your voice is very different to Bon Scott's, for example. So there's a few vocal challenges there for you.
There are vocal challenges. I think there wasn't really a challenge with AC/DC because I can sing quite high from the throat if I want to. I think the challenge, the most challenging one was probably between Purple and Zeppelin, actually.
Yeah.
You know, because they're such huge singers, them, aren't they? You know, Gillan and Plant, that I have to try and bring some of me to it. It's really difficult.
Leaving the Inspirations part two aside, I gather the new Saxon album is done. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah, the Saxon album's finished. Andy Sneap finished mixing it a couple of weeks ago. I signed it off. So that's finished. We shot a video while we were rehearsing for this show. We shot a video for the title track. So that should be out in October on a pre-release day.
And what can you tell me about it, that you're allowed to tell me about it? I mean, it's going to sound like Saxon, and I mean that in a good way, obviously.
Well, it's heavy, melodic, you know, heavy and melodic, which is what Saxon are all about. I think people are going to like it. I mean, I like it. You know, and usually, I mean, some albums we've done I didn't like, actually. But, you know, this album's great. I mean, the last 10 albums have been great, you know what I mean? But this one is great. I like it. I was listening to it, you know, the other day again for the video, to shoot the video, and it's a good album.
And those 40th anniversary shows, I mean, they were rescheduled, what, three times in the end?
Yeah, we must have seen the most loyal fans in the world, because I think we had 10 ticket returns at Hammersmith, but then we sold another 200. You know, so it's crazy. It really has been crazy. So. Only thing we can say is, you know, that we're absolutely humbled by that sort of support, you know.
And most bands that have a release date tend to have a tour also booked. So are their dates now booked?
Well, the plan is, and this is not carved in stone, obviously, because nobody knows what's happening, do we? But the plan is to do the, you know, the 40th anniversary show, the three shows we've got. I think it's Hammersmith, London, Manchester Apollo, and then Glasgow. And then we have a week's break and then we start the next tour in Europe.
And so does that allow you to look backwards for those 40th anniversaries and then forwards with lots of new material and the others?
It's going to be a mind chaos, really, because we have to do the 40th anniversary set and then we have to do the set for the new album. And then in summer, we're doing some more big festival headline shows with the Castles and Eagles again. So then we have to put that hat back on and do that show. So it's crazy.
And of course it is all tentative because you mentioned Europe, things are still on a knife edge, aren't they? And that's before we even mention Brexit and touring Europe. Is that starting to ease up a little bit?
As far as I know, it's a nightmare. Yeah. It's absolute chaos. Until bands start doing it, there's no yardstick yet. Because no bands have been there.
Yes.
So we may well be the first in February. I don't know. Luckily, all our equipment's in Germany already. So we only have to get the band there and a few of the crew.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier for us, you know. So it might be different for a lot of bands that have their equipment here, like Priest, for instance. They have their equipment in the UK, so...
So... This 18 months that we've all suffered, it sounds like you've been pretty busy just doing music, but have you found time to do those things that normally you wouldn't get to do because you're always either in the studio or on the road? Gardening, perhaps?
No, not really. I've been busy. I mean, I've done a lot of walking, actually. I went up to Northumberland and visited Hadrian's Wall and walked that, so that was fantastic. In fact, I wrote a song about it. It's the title track to the album, actually. So yeah, so a bit of research for that thing, but not really. I've not been doing much apart from touring. I've been pretty much doing what I always do, which is, like, you know, write music, do videos, you know, things like that, really.
And you had your health scare a few years ago. How are you feeling these days? And obviously the walking is part of that.
Well, walking and biking, you know, that's all part of staying fit. I don't do as much as I should, obviously. But yeah, you know, when you've had I was pretty fit before, actually. You know, I wasn't unfit. But I think probably something that creeps up on you over the years, you know, the furring up of the arteries, basically. That's what it was. So, you know, it's just one of them things, really.
Well, listen, I mean, someone like Slash has had a pacemaker since his 30s, hasn't he?
You know? Yeah, definitely. Sure. You know, they put me some new veins in there. It's like Viagra, man.
Great. Do you feel that the solo album got the attention it deserved? Because, as you said, it was awkwardly timed with the pandemic coming in, wasn't it?
Sorry, I didn't get that one.
Did you get the sense that the solo album got the attention it deserved because of the timing?
It did get the attention. It did, yeah. But I was going to tour on it and do this touring thing. Yeah. And everybody got really frightened and stopped buying tickets. So I thought, rather than just slog it out, we may as well just cancel it and do something else, you know, later on. So, it was a bit unlucky with the COVID thing for the solo album. But, you know, we can... you know, we got a video in the can for it with Fred from Opeth, so
awesome.
We might put it out again when we get a break, you know, and re-promote it.
Excellent. And so when can we expect the first single from Hadrian's Wall?
Well, the song's got Carpe Diem, mm-hmm. which is Seize the Day in Latin, obviously. And so that's the title of the new album. There, you know what it is now.
Carpe Diem it is. I literally seized the day.
Exactly.
Listen, we'll play some classic Saxon while we wait for that new material. But for now, Biff, thanks for chatting to us.
Great. Nice talking to you. Nice seeing you.